clean. So it's going to be next month. So in the middle of Sunday night, we have a spring fling. It's going to be awesome. We get to fling some spring around, gain some weight. Amen? But today, what comes up this Wednesday? Fellas, you better answer quickly. No, wrong one. Valentine's Day. Yeah. That's right. And so we're going to, I like that right there. That's the greatest Valentine's ever been. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Valentine. Isn't that cool? So what we're going to do is, I need a couple of guys up here that's got some muscles. No, sir? Oh, yeah, I can sell it to them. That's right. Come on, let two guys come up here. Y'all got to pass out some stuff for me. There's two guys. All right. Three guys. Come on. I have three. We're going to make sure we got it going good here. All right. One of y'all took the basket around, and the other two passed them out. Look at these great old bit. Hold on. Let me show you. There is giant milk chocolate with almonds. And for those that are allergic to almonds, there's giant milk chocolate with peanuts. No, I'm kidding. It's been a lot. There's one with chocolate, one with almonds. So y'all just go ahead and decide what you want when it comes through. But these guys are going to pass y'all out a Valentine. Isn't that cool? Who's going to carry it? You're going to carry it? All right, y'all guys, come and tote it out. You can pack one side, take the other side. I do want to tell y'all something about John 3:16 quickly. Yeah, they're gonna pass you out. They're gonna pass you out a chocolate bar. God's good.
All the time.
You know, John 3:16. Let me go to John 3:16 for a minute. John 3:16 is one of the greatest scriptures of all times. Psalm 23 and John 3:16 are most widely known throughout the world, even by non-Christians. And they're the most quoted. Even people that don't know the Bible, people that don't know Jesus, people that don't have any idea about what the Bible says, usually can quote Psalm 23, at least Psalm 23 of 1, and John 3:16. So y'all say it with me. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes should not perish but have everlasting life. Now, I want you to change that and change to whosoever and put me in there. Wherever you see whosoever and him, you say me. Okay, ready? Now say it out loud with me in place of whosoever and him. Ready? For God so loved me that he gave his only begotten Son that I and believe in him, and I should not perish, but have everlasting life. I had it mixed up in John
11.
Amen. So watch this. For God, here it is, for God, the greatest lover, so loved to the greatest degree, that he gave us, so loved the world, the greatest number, that he gave the greatest act, his only begotten Son, the greatest gift, that whosoever, the greatest invitation, believes the greatest simplicity, in him, the greatest person, should not perish the greatest deliverance, but have the greatest certainty, everlasting life, the greatest possession. Wow. That is powerful. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Amen. I was watching TV last night. I was relaxing on the sofa. And I heard my wife's voice from the kitchen. She said, "Oh, sweetheart, what would you like for dinner, my love? Chicken, beef, or lamb?" I said, "Well, thank you, darling. I think I have chicken." She replied, "You're having a peanut butter sandwich." I was talking to the dog. Yeah. Okay. Get your Bibles out. Turn to Galatians. I told you we'd talk about stewardship. It's not going to be, look, last week I hope people, when you were talking about tithing, that you looked at it in a whole different way, that it gave you a whole different attitude and a whole different outlook on tithing. It weren't the kind that beat you up and stuck a gun to your back and robbed you, but instead it was one of, that you really want to, it made you want to do it because you saw the benefits of what God had promised. Amen? God is awesome in his word always. Somebody say always.
Always.
That's right. I guess somebody telling you're looking good. I know you can't help it. That's right. And if you could help it, you would still look good. say now, Galatians, I was over here. Praise God, stop doing, look, you know, how many people like to multitask? I found out, I'm very good at multitasking, so I can't find Galatians. I'm very good at multitasking, except for every now and then, I used to multitask with my jobs all the time. Especially as an engineer, you have to multitask in order to survive. But what I found out was, in multitasking, I found out one of my psychological courses that to multitask temporarily zaps your IQ at least, this is the minimum, it zaps your IQ 10%. Some of us can't afford to lose 10%. I can, amen? So, just think about this thing you're trying to multitask. Multitasking zaps your brain. It takes away about 10% of your IQ. And some people, it takes even more away. And I'm not going to point anybody. I'm looking up what I'm saying. Amen. But God is so good. All the time.
God is good.
There you go. So Galatians. Galatians chapter 6. Seven laws of the harvest. We're going to go over this for a couple of weeks. Seven laws of the harvest stand for the reading of the word. Galatians chapter 6. I think about the poor man. I thought about that dog feeding the dogs. I think about that poor man on his deathbed. They were expecting to die at any time. He was totally drained, exhausted. He was waiting to take his last breath. And all of a sudden he smelled his wife's homemade cookies that she hadn't made in years. And he started smelling it. He said, am I going to heaven already? He said, my wife's cooking those cookies. And so he musters every bit of strength he can. He gets on, he falls out of the bed. He crawls through the door. He pulls himself on the knob. He gets up there and he holds on to the stairs. He goes one stair at a time. It takes him countless minutes to get downstairs. He still smells like a greater and greater and greater smell. When he finally gets to the kitchen, he says, there they are. And he says, she's making them. And so he reaches down and grabs one. And about the time he grabs one, she slaps his hand and says, stop that! That's for your funeral. Yeah. Some of y'all got this. Galatians chapter 6, verse 7. Be not deceived. Be not deceived by others. Especially be not deceived by Satan. And most of all, be not deceived by your own thinking. The older we get, if we're not careful, the more mature we get, if we're not careful, we begin to think that we're really getting it together. We've got it all together. If we're not careful, guess what happens? We start deceiving ourselves. Watch this. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. Whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. I like the way the Bible says, whatsoever man saith, he shall have. That word saith also can be translated as soweth with his mouth. Whatsoever man soweth with his mouth, he shall have. Here it is here. Whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also reap. For he that soweth through his flesh shall the flesh reap corruption, but he that soweth through the Spirit shall the Spirit reap life everlasting. Let us not be weary in well-doing. In other words, I know you're doing right. I sometimes look at God and say, God, I keep doing right, but I keep getting wrong. I don't understand. I keep doing what you said, but I keep getting wrong. I keep stepping out. The more I step out, the more my hands get slapped, the more my toes get stepped on. God, when is it going to change? Here's what he says. Be not weary in well-doing. For in due season we shall reap. Y'all say shall. That's a promise. It's coming. Think somebody say it's coming. Think somebody say them checks in the mail. If we faint not, the word faint means give up. If we do not give up, we're going to reap it. As we have therefore opportunity, let us do good unto all men, especially unto them who are of the household of faith. Father, I love you, Lord. I praise your name. I thank you for your grace and thank you for your mercy. I know, God, you're not well on the throne, Father. I know, God, that you have what we need. We, Lord, you had it before we ever needed it. You have it before we ever asked for it. But God, you set up a system, a set of laws. And God, in this set of laws, you give man a chance to respond to your word and respond to your urgings and to respond to the moving of the Spirit. And Father, I ask you right now, Lord, to minister to all of us in a very powerful way right now. Help us, God, to see, to know, to understand that you got something very special waiting for us on the other side. And even right there's some special stuff waiting for us if we follow your way. And would you just agree in church then? Amen. Way down, get somebody high five, low five, no five, 4 1/4, and say, God is so good. Amen. Amen. There's Bonnetoon and Bakersfield. All the bees over here, the bee row, but here's the Bonnetoon district, and there's the Bakersfield district right here. That's the A row, B row. I just want to be on the zero. Alright, here we go. Going down here quick. I'm going to just be quiet. Here we go. I'm not going to be quiet when I'm telling jokes, but I'm not even going to stop doing that. I'll just keep on so my last. Okay, here we go. Get ready. Get ready. Here we go. God is so awesome. Remember we talking about this year? Because it's 2018, I looked at those numbers. I believe in numerology. I believe God is into numerology. I believe that I'm not talking about some old crazy mess where you pull out the cars and all this. I'm talking about numerology. God, there's threes in God's economy. There's seven. Seven is the number of completion. Three is the number of trial. 40. Three is also the number of power and of trial. 12 is the number of wisdom and judgment. So you look at all this stuff. God's got all these numbers. But remember, 2018. So first, 2,000 years ago was the resurrection. 18 numerology, or if you number the alphabet, this is 18. And 18 means new life. And 8 means the number of new beginnings. So I honestly can look at this year and I can see that there's going to be some resurrections, some things you thought were dead and gone, some things you thought would never work, some things you thought would never get back in gear, some things you thought would never even happen. It was over, it was dead, it was buried, it was gone. It's going to resurrect, it's going to have some new life, and there's going to be some new beginnings. Look at how it all lines up. That is amazing how that is. So look at somebody and tell them, hold on, something's coming. That's right. Y'all can be a little louder. I can hear you. Hold on, something's coming. Okay. So now, so watch this now. If we want God to fully work in our lives, if we want to really see God work in our lives, then you're going to have to take him off the shelf, you're going to have to polish him off, and you're going to have to sit him beside you and let him lead you and guide you. You're going to have to do your part. If you don't do your part, then you just as well not even have God be working for you, because you're waiting for God to spoon feed you. When you're a baby, yes, you get spoon fed. But once you get the age up on you, you start feeding yourself. I love it. I absolutely love it when I hear the cooing and ah-ahs and the coos, and I have to part the lips of a baby to put a pacifier in its mouth, but it gets aggravating when I got to part a mustache to do it. Okay, I'm going to get there eventually. Ready? That's right. So look. So he sets up these laws, okay? So let's just kind of see some of his laws. God sets up a system of laws. Of course, these laws are principles that govern, they guide us, that they govern nature, they govern the universe. You can't change these laws. You can try your best, but you cannot change these laws. These laws are universal. Being that it happens everywhere, it's the same way everywhere you go. How many of you ever put dropped a nickel and dropped a feather at the same time and seen which landed the hardest, which landed first? Then how many of you ever put it in a vacuum and dropped it and seen the difference? Amen. But you know what? What comes up has got to come down. What you know, there's more room out than there is in. There's all kinds of stuff, you know, the old-fashioned way we talked about it, but they're universal. They're simple, and they're absolute. They're not going to change. These are laws that God set up, and they're stable. And because they're stable, that's when they're deciding that they're a law, when they are stable, absolute, that it's not going to change. And I'm just going to tell you a couple of them quickly, and then we're going to go into this today's message. Here we go. Know the rules. Amen. Get ready. See, God set up a system of rules. There's a law of gravity. Y'all help me out. What goes up? Amen. There's the law of mathematics. Two parallel lines do not meet. 1 + 1 = 2, except with hamsters and rabbits. But then he got us 2 hamsters, and in just a little while we had 28. Then he kept trying to give away. He couldn't give away fast enough. We had them all over the place. They were coming out of our ears, hamsters. Amen. There's the law of house. day you clean is the day your kids bring home guests. Or that you don't clean, excuse me. Or the day you clean, here we show you one. If I haven't cleaned up, they bring somebody. Or if I do clean up and I don't want it messed up, they bring somebody. Amen. All right, the law of the prophets. This is one of the best ones of all. As the law of the prophets says, watch this. It says, what you want men to do to you, you do unto them. Matter of fact, God's laws, if you'll look at his laws, if you'll watch his laws, and you'll see what it says. Come on, everybody, you can do this. I know you can. I got confidence on you. That's what my grandma used to say. I got confidence on you, son. Here you go. There we are. God's laws, remember, they're simple. They do not change. You can bank on it. It's going to happen. It will take place. You watch it. Remember you talking about the other night, last week, when I had no longer had dental insurance and Daniel had this really expensive tooth in his mouth and this he knocked out with the shovel? And there I was on top of the church saying, I'm going to pay for this now because I don't have insurance and I'm really not in a position to put that $1,000 tooth back in his mouth. And in comes a guy working to talk to the mechanic I was working with up on the roof. And I said, who is that guy? He says, he's the local dentist. So there he was. I asked him about Daniel's tooth. He said, bring him down here. He looked at him, examined him, and said, he'll be fine. Door opened the back. He was getting ready to fall out anyway. Wow. Now, if I'd have had insurance with his office, he probably would have fixed it. Okay, we'll leave it alone. There's no dentist in here, is there? there was a dentist. He had a pipe break in his house, so he called for a plumber. The plumber came with a $2 pipe and took him about 15 minutes to change the pipe. Said it'll be $150. So $150 for a little piece of tube and 15 minutes worth of work. He said, yes, $150 an hour. You're paying for my service call. No matter what, you're paying $150. I said, I'm a dentist. I don't make that kind of money. He said, I know. I used to be a dentist. You reap what you sow. Whenever you cast your bread upon the water, the Bible says it will come back. Whatever you do, if you take care of people, I learned a long time ago, if you help enough people meet their need, then there's going to be God in them helping you meet yours. If you help enough people get what they're desiring to get, I'm not talking about some Mickey Mouse mess, but you're helping somebody, it will come back to you. There was this one lady I heard about. She had a desire. She lived in a poor neighborhood, and she was law enforcement. She lived in a poor neighborhood, and those kids had a bad school, and it was really kind of rough. It was an inner city, and she wanted to be able to give those kids some good books, and she's trying to give them some good books, and she's trying to get something for them. She didn't have any money. And one night, she got an alarm, and she goes in and checks this alarm in this warehouse, and she sees thousands upon thousands upon thousands of books. They were getting ready to discard them because they had minor glitches in them and minor cosmetic problems. So they were going to destroy all these thousands and thousands and thousands of books. They were the age group for the kids she wanted to help. So she goes to the owner and says, what are you going to do with these books? He said, we're going to destroy them. She said, well, you know what? I'm trying to get something going for the kids around here. They don't have anything. It would really be nice if I could get these books. He said, you can have these books with anyone else that comes along. And not only did she get a chance to give these books free, she was trying to help the man, and the man wound up helping her, giving her all these books. And not only that, but she got the books that came afterwards, and it wound up building the foundation. And it was amazing what had happened. But it all started with her trying to help those kids, and her trying to help that man, and how God intervened. You reap what you sow. I can't say it enough. And we'll talk about it a little bit more, but you reap what you sow. You can't change it. You can try. I'm going to get right down to the rubber, Mr. Road. If you've got, I hear people say, everybody I meet's got the meanest, roughest attitude. Everybody I meet's right sour. And I look at God and say, well, why don't you look in the mirror and see why? If everybody you meet has that, if everybody you know has a problem, then the problem's not them. Look in the mirror. Because you're reaping what you sow. So here we go. Let's go ahead now. We're going to get past the boomerang here. Praise God. And we're going to talk a little bit. Ready? Y'all ready? All right. Praise God. So here we go. God set up a system of laws, and because there are no laws more important or significant than the principles that govern the harvest that we reap, here's what we're going to talk about. This is the most important thing in your life. Next to knowing Jesus Christ, your personal Savior, that gets you ready for heaven. But this is how you handle it on earth. It's very important. It's called the law of harvest. Again, whatsoever a man sows, he shall reap. Mom used to tell me, Mama's way of telling me was, son, every night when I go out on a date, every night when I go out and party with the guys when I was a teenager, whatever I do when I leave the house, Mama would say, remember, son, if you dance, you got to pay the fiddler. Anybody ever heard that?
Yes.
Or she'd say, remember, son, if you make that bed, you're going to have to sleep in it, so you better make it right. So again, that's the hillbilly version, the possum track version of sowing and reaping. Life is an echo. What you send out comes back. It's a boomerang snare. What you sow, you reap. What you give, you get. What you see in others exists in you. Did you know that? If somebody's driving you crazy with some of their attitudes and driving you crazy on a consistent basis, maybe it's because you see something in them that you don't even like in yourself and you don't even realize you're doing it. I've known people that just chewed up other people over things, and I want to say, look, I have. I've thought, look, while you're beating them up over this, I want you to do me a favor. Go to the bathroom and look in the mirror and beat that person in the mirror up, because that person's doing the exact same thing that you're mad at them for what they're doing. If you need understanding, give understanding. If you need love, give love. If you need God to bless you and your finances, then give some away. You need help? Then go help somebody else. You need some arms, then you go be arms for somebody else. I'm telling you, it's important. It cannot be changed. God set up this law. This law is eternal. It is simple. And it is universal. It works even with people that don't know Jesus Christ. They know some of these rules. This is one of the rules they know, and they practice. I've seen people. I don't believe in God, but I believe in reaping what you sow. And so they go around and do it, and then God blesses them abundantly. So now watch this. Laws of the harvest. Laws of the harvest can be divided into seven laws and three basic principles. And we're going to talk about that over the next couple of weeks. First is, listen to this now. Harvest, please listen carefully. Your harvest is always a consequence. I don't like what I'm getting, God. I don't like what's happening to me. I don't like what's happening here. I don't like the way this thing's going. I don't like it going south like it's going. Of course, we do have battles, and there is, don't let me go get it mixed up. There is battles that we have to fight. There's all that kind of stuff. But I'm talking about the consequence of harvest, what you are getting. Your harvest is always a consequence. You always, somebody say always.
Always.
You always reap what you sow. That's not my word, that's his. Matter of fact, you know what I want to be talking about? I want to be talking about families. I've been dealing in sociology right now, Christian sociology, and the Lord has inspired me in a bunch of different ways to put some sermons on family. I want to do that today. And even Valentine's is coming up. And so I did a little thing about Valentine's, but the Lord just keeps telling me, tell the people, show the people. Don't be slack. Show the people. This is more important right now. So last week, this week, and in the weeks to come. Harvest is a consequence. You can't blame somebody else for your harvest. Come on. Help me out here. Y'all getting awful quiet. Look, there's the pen I heard drop last week. I can hear it again. Amen. So here we go. Your harvest is always a consequence. Always. So let's watch this now. We're going to get on through here. I'm going to go ahead and try to get y'all out of here so y'all can go. Y'all can get rid of the old me look. Ready? Whosoever sows generously shall also reap generously. If I go down the row and put one kernel of corn every 12 foot, or I go down and put three kernels of corn every 6 inches, or I just saw it straight on down. That determines how much corn I'm going to get. I can blame y'all. Well, it's your fault that my corn ain't doing like it can. My corn ain't good as yours. My mind is only getting up one stalk. If I'm only getting one stalk, you got three. Well, maybe because they planted three kernels of corn, you planted one. How come yours is all the way down just as pretty and bountiful, and mine is scarce? Because they planted all the way down, and they planted generously. Whosoever sows generously, it's not me talking, it's the Bible. Whosoever sows generously shall reap generously. So now let's just get a little bit into this, and then we're going to let y'all go. I've only got about 50 slides. I'm playing. I'm generous, that's right, I'll be generous with the slides. Okay, so the first law can be divided in, watch this. If we are not reaping, watch this, watch carefully. We reap from what we sow, and we also reap from what others sow. Sometimes we reap from what our children sow. Sometimes we reap from what our wife or our husband sows. Sometimes we reap from what our boss sows. So our direct harvest is what we sow, but our indirect harvest is from what other people sow around us. So what's this? But sowing always, 100% of the time, sowing always involves seeds. Seeds equal potential. They found some seeds in the in one of the pyramids. They found the seeds because when Pharaoh died, they put seeds in there. They even killed a servant and put a servant in there to have for the next life, put his animals in there, and put all these in there with him, put stuff with him, put weapons with him, put housewares, even put seeds so he could have it in the next life. But they found this seed, and these seeds are several thousand years old. But these seeds were still stored in the pyramids. Thousands of years old, they take the seeds and they plant it in the ground. And it sprouted. You see, some of us carry our seeds in our pocket and wonder why it's not growing. I don't understand. I started. I'm going to let these pennies be seeds. I got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Isn't that cool? God's number. When I came here tonight, I had 7 pennies. Do you know why I still got 7 pennies? When I leave, I'm going to have 7 pennies. Why? God even says, go ahead and put it in your pocket, but I'm going to tell you what's going to happen. If you neglect to sow the seed, I'm going to help a hole form in that pocket. Well, hey, I said, you put money in bags with holes in it. But if I plant it, wow, if I plant it, something amazing happens. This is just seeds. It don't have to be money. It can be how I handle people. It can be going and helping somebody, reaching out and being a hand for somebody else, or going out of my way and forget about myself and help somebody else. Doing something above and beyond. We went to the Penitentiary Center Thursday night. We planted a whole lot of seeds. A whole lot of seeds. You know what? It took time. It took effort. And bless our hearts, we were so tired and wore out by the end, we could barely make it to Krispy Kreme. Okay, we weren't wore out, but this Krispy Kreme sure tasted good. Amen. Okay. Amen. That was our reward. Amen. So here we go.
Thank you.
All right. So here we go. Seed equals potential. Seeds always produce a harvest. Harvest causes results. So if you keep them in your pocket, the results are going to be. If you, I hear people all the time. I want one day. This person was having problems with his family. Having big problems with his family. I walked up on him. He was outside. He was praying. I prayed. He was sitting in the swing. And I looked at him. He said, I'm having this problem with my family. I said, really? I said, because they don't think you care about them. They don't care. They think you even have any concern about them. He says, but I sit here every morning. It's a praise that I think about every one of them individually every day. I think of what they're going through and blah, 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 blah. And it's very concerning to me. And I said, have you ever told them that? He said, no, they know that. Really, that's why everybody thinks that you're an old bag. A grumpy old man. Because when they come around, you get them right there! You should know better! Blah, 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 blah. But in the morning when you get up, you're going, he's having a problem. I wonder what we could do to make it blah, 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 blah. But he never tells them. He never shows them. See, a blessing is not spoken. It's not a blessing at all. It's a blessing withheld. So while you got a chance, you tell those people in your life that you love them. While you got a chance, you tell them that you got that you want to work with them. You tell them that they're doing a great job. You tell them while they're still here. Because I stood over a mania coffin. And I just looked at that person in there and I thanked them and I said, but you know what? They're not hearing this. I should have thanked them when they were here. Well, it's pretty noble to stand over the coffin and go, thank you so much for what you've done. Yeah, they didn't hear that. They're in heaven, rejoicing. But you see, you got to remember, you reap what you sow. So here we go. I'm almost through. I said almost. Well, okay, maybe. All right. So here we go. You're ready. If you want kindness, be kind. If you want friends, be friendly. The Bible says if you want friends, you've got to show yourself friendly. If you want help, be helpful. If you want love, be loving. If you want respect, respect yourself. I was in Lowe's yesterday, and I was trying to do some plumbing work. I went in Lowe's and got stuff. I come back home, and it was the wrong stuff. I went back. I'm out of the house getting my stuff again. Everybody's busy, and I'm waiting on me, so I'm having to wait on myself. One guy came by and said, you don't know anything about plumbing. I said, that's obvious. This is my second trip. Duh. And when I went to go out, there was a young lady at the checkout counter, and for just the strangest reason, I just heard the Lord say, just bless her. Lift her up. And so I said, well, I really don't know what to do right now. Honestly, I said, well, lift her up. So I just said, she said, you got my Lowe's card? And I said, why would I have your Lowe's card? And the Lord's wondering, said, that's all I'm talking about. She laughed. And I said, you have such a beautiful smile. Matter of fact, your hair is gorgeous. You know, I see your going places, you know. And then all of a sudden, here comes somebody else, and then somebody else, and somebody else. And before long, I had people hugging me everywhere and talking to me and blah, blah, blah. I was giving high fives and low fives. You know, you're good, blah, blah. And I had my card stuck into the reader, and I hit the wrong button. And she said, I think you hit the wrong button. I said, yeah, I'm multitasking. Lost 10% of my brain right then. I said, no, I'm too busy talking to everybody else. I should be paying attention to this. I said, but you know, I'm so shy. She said, I don't think that's a problem. Well, let that love. The Lord showed it to me. I was blessing her. And while I was blessing her, four or five people come up and blessed me. Immediately. It wasn't like down the road. Immediately. Well, it was coming out of my mouth to her. People were coming up hugging on me and giving me high fives and all kinds of stuff. And it was just so amazing that I was trying to be a blessing to her and lift her up. And while I was lifting her up, here come these others being a blessing to me. Wow. If you need to be lifted up, lift up somebody else. You can't walk around looking like you've been sucking on lemon juice and kiss the mule right square in the mouth. They'll not even go to prison. And my dog come loving on me. And I'm getting to walk out the door. My dog's loving on me. I said, hey, Maddie, how you doing, girl? About time she stuck her nose right in my mouth. It was terrible. I said, oh, that tastes awful. And Linda says, you don't know the worst of it. She just had her nose up Inky's butt. That's TMI. He gotta be a blessing. Amen. So here we go. Look, I'm finishing this. You will most often get more of the things that matter in life by giving them first than you will ever get by trying desperately to get them or asking for them. I learned a long time ago that when I was at Procter & Gamble, when I was at Fountain, I didn't have to ask people when they were working with me. I didn't have to say, y'all need to listen to what I say. You need to do exactly what I say. Blah, 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 blah. Because I always try to think, how would I feel if I was telling me something I needed to do? Or if I was in a bind or something, how would I handle this? And so again, it was just wonderful. We had a wonderful relationship. It was because I knew that whatever I sowed, I was going to reap. So now, reaping for what others sow. Okay, get ready. I'm getting close. Do what others sow. See, now we can receive positive blessings because of, look, what we can look. Think about this. The greatest person we reap for what others sow, the greatest person I can think of is what God has done on our behalf. The cross. It was His decision. It was His action. And what others have done on our behalf. There's others that have made right choices. We're in a nice church today because somebody made the right choices to build this church and to make it like it is. And right actions. So people still keep it up and keep it going. So we're blessed by this. We're blessed coming in. We're blessed going out. There's things about your own house. There's things you're blessed about because your parents did for you. Or your children are doing it for you now. It's just amazing when you think about how you're reaping rewards that you didn't even have to sow because they sowed before you. That's the indirect harvest. Amen? But it has a big impact on you. But it's also negative. Amen? We reap what others have sown, bad choices and bad actions. There's kids that went hungry last night because their parents made bad choices. There's people, people that were abused last night because their spouse or somebody else made bad choices. So there's positive, the cross, good things. But there's also negative, bad choices, bad actions. So now get ready. Then that's the indirect harvest. But then there is the direct harvest. All it is. Don't judge each day by the harvest you reap, but by the seeds that you plant. I try to remember that all the time. I was watching Bethany, and I was watching her in Walmart one day. I was watching how she was handling people. And there was somebody that was trying to get her child up, and there was some problems. She was trying to help pick that child up, and she put stuff over. And there was somebody else was having a hard time. She went, and of course, she knew the person. She put her arm around him, and she started loving on him, and she said, it's going to be okay. Just that one day, watching her for about 15, 20 minutes, how she ministered to so many people. And when she got fed, I said, you know what, girl, that was amazing. I'm so proud of you. And she said, well, Dad, I learned it from you. Oh, my head didn't swell up because then she did something stupid. said, so you're working in the plumber. I said, yeah. I said, let me tell you what happened last night. I told him the story I just told y'all. And Eddie, in his wisdom, and his other, he needed to put a little lock up, a little store thing, a little thing up there at Walmart, charge 5 cents like Lucy on the peanuts for advice. Eddie said, well, at least you know she's not an idiot. I said, where's he going with this? I said, why is that, Eddie? He said, because even an idiot would look at it and say, somebody's working on that thing. Thank you, Eddie. That made it all worth it. I've gotten a few miles out of that one, the other ones too. Because the next night, because what happened was the seal broke again. After I put the seal in, the seal actually broke. And it was leaking. So I said, Bethany, help me. As I'm taking the gooseneck out, it's got water in it. I'm under the sink. Bethany's helping me. I'm under the sink. It's got water in it, so I'm trying not to get it. I pulled it down, trying not to spill it. And I'm looking up, and I take it and throw it right back in the sink. And she says, well, at least you're not an idiot, Dad. That's funny. Okay, here you are. That's funny. All right. Okay, here we go. So let's go ahead. I'm getting carried away here. Let's go. All right. Leap along beside. We can receive positive or we can receive negative. Matter of fact, it's what we plan. You have choices every day. I have to think about that sometimes. I'm thinking, do I really want to let him have it? Do I really want to give it to him? You know, do I really want to let him know? You know, like the guy pulled in front of me, sped past me, and he parked in a handicapped spot and jumped out of his car, didn't have a handicapped sticker, and run in the drugstore, and I was so mad I wanted to give him a piece of my mind. You have plenty of parking in a handicapped spot. Handicapped people should be. You about run me over, my family. How did I get you? I'm in the drugstore anyway, so I was thinking about it. I heard a man say, hurry, hurry, hurry. My child has a very high fever. The doctor told me to give her this medicine now. Oh. Open for the back of my eye. It's her foot. I'm glad I didn't get a piece of my mind. I couldn't afford to lose that much. So, our choices, not only our choices, but our actions. How am I healing today? How am I doing today? You know, remember years ago, remember Christmas years ago, and I was in D.C. a camera for Christmas. I don't know if you remember this camera. One of the first digital cameras is about as big as a house. And they had them on sale. They're normally $300. It was that. Back when they didn't have, when they had Black Friday on Black Friday, not on Thursday. And they had it at Walmart, and they were on sale for like $79, $59, $67, really a $300 camera. And I get ready to run, I'm running into Walmart to get this thing. And I walk in, and here's this lady pushing this cart. And she got carts and kids, and she's trying to get them out the store, and she's so just, you can see she was just. And she's trying to push and she can't get them. And I said, and the Lord said, you need to help that lady. I said, I'm trying to get that camera. There's only a few of them in the store. I said, I can't afford to miss that camera. He said, you can't afford not to help that lady. I said, but Lord, I argued with him. Of course, he won. I said, man, can I help you? She said, oh, thank you. Nobody's even trying to help. They're just pushing me down, pushing me over. So I got one of her carts, and she got a cart, and we watched the kids, and we went out, and she was parked at the other end of the parking lot. I'm thinking, there goes the camera. At the other end of the parking lot, and bless her heart, I think if she was to be resurrected as an animal, she'd have been a sloth. Because she would. And I said, the camera! She goes, huh? I said, nothing. Then I thought maybe she thought she was going to Dancing with the Stars. I wasn't sure. We finally get everything in her car. And I said, is that it? She says, that's it. And before she could grab it, I slammed the door down for her. And I grabbed the cart and I run to the with you, sir? I said, no, never mind. I said, I wanted one of those cameras, but she said they'd been gone for, they'd been gone for 10 minutes. I've been out in the yard for 10 minutes. I said, well, okay, never mind. She said, I started walking away as I'm walking away. She said, sir, hold on just a minute. I said, what? She said, the strangest thing, there's one under the counter. Here, you can have it. See, the Lord showed me, do his business, he'll take care of yours. And he got the camera, amen, it was pretty cool. All right, so now, remember, listen to this carefully. Every choice, every action that you make today, even right now, as we're sitting here, every choice, every action is seed, is potential. You can listen and you can learn and say, God, help me apply it to my life and things will go good. Or you can sit and go, you know what? He don't know what he's talking about. Blah, 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 blah. And you know what? It's just as well be warm on the lips back and you go over here saying, wait a minute, what did he say? It's important. You see, we can reap negative. See, if you don't like what you're reaping, change what you're sowing. Craziest thing, D.C., Daniel, and Beth all did this. D.C.'s a little thing. After he finally got some hair, now he's got a head full. I remember one day he was screaming. And I walked in. I said, what is wrong? He had a handful of hair. And he's pulling and crying. Son, nobody's hurting you but you. Let go of your hair. Daniel did the same thing. Bethany decided she didn't like broccoli. Mary decided she was going to make her eat it anyway. She sat at the table for, I kid you not, this is her testimony, 45 minutes with the broccoli in her mouth. She wouldn't swallow it because she didn't like the way it tasted. In your mouth for 45 minutes. You wouldn't swallow it. I said, Bethany, does it taste bad? Mm-hmm. You know how to get rid of it? You can't spit it out. Mama's looking. Mm-hmm. What you going to do? Ooh. Swallow! Right here. We're sowing tomato seeds trying to get apples. We're sowing lemon seeds trying to get oranges. You got to sow the right thing if you want to get the right thing. So here it goes. Negative. He that soweth iniquity shall reap vanity, which means, hey, nothing's going to, vanity doesn't necessarily mean you think you're bad in the bone. Vanity sometimes means emptiness. You're doing this in vain. Those that have sown the wind shall reap more wind, Hosea 7. James 4:17, it says, therefore to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is a sin. There's a sin of commission and a sin of omission. The sin of commission, if I walked up and I did somebody harm, I actually put my hands on them and hurt them. That's a sin of commission. But if I saw somebody being abused and I could stop it, and I don't, and I walk away from it, that's a sin of omission. I could have done something and I didn't. So what I've discovered is the greatest sin in the church is a sin of omission. Because we should be doing things and we're not. Wait for somebody else to do it. Wait for somebody else to take care of it because I'm tired. Well, we're all tired. You know, we've all got things to do. We've all got problems. We've all got to make it. What we do is when we pull together, you know, when we pull together, we lighten the load tremendously. So, again, now we can reap what we sow. Now, what's this? Did I go backwards? I think I went backwards again. Okay, here's positive. Here we go. I don't know why I keep doing that. I don't do it anywhere but up there. Psalm 26. It says, he that sows in tears shall reap in joy. He that goeth forth and weepeth, bringeth barren precious seed, shall doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing his sheaves with him. I remember the Andy Griffith Show. Every time they sang in church, it was bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves. Remember that? Of course, in the Mouse Church, they sang, bringing in the sheaves. Bringing in the sheaves. Okay, here we go. Galatians 6, 9 and 10. Let us not be weary while doing, for in due season we will reap if we faint not. As we therefore have our opportunity. opportunity, let's do good unto all men, but especially to our brothers and sisters in the Lord. Wow. Again, life is echo. What you send out comes back. What you sow, you reap. What you give, you get. What you see in others actually exists in you. So, here's my question. I'm getting ready to close. Y'all, musicians. Musicians, not magicians. Leave your rabbits out there. Musicians, you get ready.